Gracias por estar con nosotros. Bienvenidos a este.
Welcome to this analysis on social media in Latin America within the framework of the World Economic Forum celebrated here in Panama. We are having one of the last sessions. I hope for it to be interesting and for us to have a very good time as well. I'm going to thank all of our guests for being here, especially Mr. Castro. He is an important guest. Thank you for being here. Luis de la Calle, he's an economist. We have a very, we have a table full of economists, and it's good because of the topic that we're going to address. Luis de la Calle is director and founder of Madrazo, Mancera, an economist of the Autonomous Institute of Mexico. Arif Naqvi, who is the founder of the group Abraaj from the United Emirates, thank you for being here. And he's a co-president or co-chair of the World Economic Forum as well on Latin America. Thank you. Marcelo, Côrtes, Neri, ministers of strategic affairs from Brazil, with a PhD in economy from Princeton. He's another economist. Thank you very much. We are at a time that is one of inflection in Latin America. Recent reports of the World Bank have shown that the middle class, for the first time, has a key role, a preponderant role within the Latin American society. It is estimated, and I'm not a person to question these numbers from the World Bank, but it is said that the middle class is now superior than the lower class for about 32%. And the people that have a lower income situation are 30%. However, the World Bank recognizes that there are still many challenges ahead of us. We have a middle class that is growing, but we still have a low class that is very vulnerable to changes. We have high poverty rates in the poverty that is affecting mainly the youth. And this is a very young region. And also, it's affecting women, where most of the people in the population are women, and they are also that economy driver in most of the cases in the household. So there are a series of social debts that haven't been met. And we still also have a middle class that could become a problem as well, a problem for governance in some countries. This is the middle class. They are the ones that also put pressure for better levels of education, better levels of health care, et cetera. They're the ones that go out in the streets in many of Latin American countries in order to demand certain rights. So there are many questions to answer of how prepared Latin America is precisely to have a robust middle class, which not necessarily means an internal consumption driver. That is something important to consider. I would like to talk about a principle in a technical debate, and I'm not going to deepen on this, but we want to talk a little bit about the definition of middle class, because we have an issue there too. Every country has a different definition. In fact, there are surveys, and it turns out that the middle class is higher. In Mexico, we have had certain surveys, and they all say, people, when they're asked, that they're from middle class. People say, well, I consider myself middle class. And even people that are of higher class consider themselves middle class, and vice versa, from lower classes consider themselves middle class. Perhaps if you ask me, I would say I'm middle class. But perhaps it's not that way. We'd have to see what is the technical definition. And I'd like to begin with Luis de la Calle. I know that it's a difficult debate, but what is, in your opinion, the most accurate definition of a middle class in Latin America? Thank you very much, Mario, for the opportunity. I think that the technical discussion of what is or what is not middle class is one of a second degree of importance. In Latin America, we can say with much certainty that most of the population is not poor. And this is a novelty because in Latin America, historically speaking, if we have a sensory assessment, when compared to 150 years ago, most of the population was poor, and that wasn't too long ago. They were extremely poor. 40 years ago, 80% of Mexicans were poor. And nowadays, we're discussing if the poor are the majority or not. And so as a country is not poor by a majority, per definition, then the country is not a poor country. And so I feel that the most important aspect of acknowledging that most of the population is not poor and rather is of middle class is that it removes that excuse for not doing things the way that they should be. Many politicians and analysts have taken poverty as an excuse to say, well, I didn't build the stadium right, or this road was crooked, the bridge fell down, oh, we're too poor, that's the reason. And so there are excuses. I can't have a good first world class justice administration system because we're poor. And so when we change the perspective or the worldview to self-define ourselves as middle-class countries, we're setting forth the foundation for true development. And you are right. If you ask Mexicans if they consider themselves middle-class or not, they're going to say 75% of them will say, yes, we are middle-class. And who are we, analysts, to tell them, no, no, you're not. You're not middle-class because you're poor and you don't have a future. The growth of middle class is going to have an enormous impact in the political development, economical, and social of Latin America. Of course, the politicians love to put a medal on their chest and to say, thanks to them or their programs, people are more or less poor, or they have had access to becoming middle class. I think that that is completely false. People's progress is 90% due to their own effort. They wake up early, they work, they study, they educate their children, they invest in their household, they invest in a vehicle or a car, they go to the university, they invest in assets, and 10% are government programs. And I think that in the World Economic Forum, the question should be, rather, trying to find the business of the future. The explosive growth of Latin America and the middle class is the greatest opportunity for business in our history. And the enterprises or companies that are going to be successful are those that become the bridge between the informality and formality. That is, that transition from informality to formality, a business, to make it a business, and to make the transition in a way that we're going to have an explosive development and growth in Latin America. We are already seeing examples of companies that have seen in the transformation of a middle-class society as an opportunity for business. That's really what's going to trigger the business the most, more than the public policies or the discussions in terms of sustainable growth in a country or region. I think that you're right in many regard, but the threshold or the spectrum of middle class is very broad. You talk about an explosion of middle class, but we don't know yet if they can really become a consumption driver internally. I'd have my reservations or doubts with respect to that. It's not the same to make $2.50 per day, which is for a country considered middle class, than to earn $50 a day per hour. I mean, in Mexico, when you're pressured by analysts to ask who is right of who is middle class or not, the analysts from the desk say, in the Mexican case at least, that it's a country that is mostly poor because the investments open malls once per day, every day. Let's go to Mr. Côrtes Neri because there are personal opinions. You've already talked about stadiums that are not well constructed. Now let's talk about the situation in Brazil, and I think that's a good example. Please.
I think we have, when we normally talk in middle class, we normally think about U.S. middle class with, you know, two cars, two dogs, a swimming pool. This is not the Latin American middle class. This is not the world middle class, in my opinion. I think it's fair, you know, it's a free world, we can think. Latin America, Brazil in particular, but Latin America as a whole, is the middle of the world, you know, like our per capita PPP income is very much close to the world's income distribution in the Latin America, although it's very, very unequal. It's very similar to the inequality in the world. So what I like to think is about a traditional middle class thinking about a U.S. type of middle class or European, and Latin America, in Brazil and Mexico, etc., but which is in fact a world middle class. And I think, in fact, given that inequality has been falling in most of Latin American countries in the last decade, in Brazil still falling, I think it makes quite, we are talking about millions of people. That's also another difference, even because you may be talking about emerging countries like other BRIC countries, and where there is a growing middle class, but from the top, because inequality is going up, while in Latin America, in Brazil in particular, there are people coming from the bottom. And I think now maybe we are seeing some sort of, after 10, 12 years of this growth of this middle class, we are maybe seeing some sort of a conflict between the traditional middle class and the new middle class, because the infrastructure, there is a bottleneck, for example, cars in the road, we see here in Panama City, we see in Rio, in São Paulo, in Mexico City, or in the airports, which I think is a great opportunity. But I think there are many middle classes, but I think the Latin American middle class is, in a way, the world middle class.
Now, in Brazil, the middle class has become an important driver for internal consumption. We can see that in the numbers of active vehicles that are purchased, cars. In Mexico, at least, we dream of selling a million units. And I think that in Brazil, the number is a lot higher than in Mexico. Yes, surely.
3 years ago, about 11% of the people who flew, was the first time they ever flew in their lives. The people who bought tickets. So there is this phenomenon of people raising, from very low standards of living. And this makes quite a big challenge for firms, because instead of targeting the top 10% or top 20%, they have to have a much broader view of the whole economy, of the whole society, have distribution channels, communication strategy, not only from the top. But this has been an engine of growth. I think we cannot only use, consumption. I think the key challenge is how to be a production channel, the middle class, the production side of the middle class, which is the bright side of the middle class. But in my opinion, this has been already occurring. The greatest revolution of the middle class started when women decide to have not 6 kids but 2 kids. These kids went to school, they are getting formal jobs, not so much entrepreneurs as I would like, but they're getting formal jobs, and I think there is a production revolution. That's what it makes more sustainable than if it was only on consumption. And perhaps the biggest test the Brazilian middle class had was this low growth from the last 3 years, 4 years. In spite of that, the Brazilian middle class is still going up in spite of the macro conditions.
From the point of view of investment from the group that you lead, I think you have an interesting position. Do you agree with what you've seen here, and how have you seen the development in the region and the empowerment of the middle class?
So, thank you. I think the reason you have me on this panel is to perhaps try and provide a more balanced external perspective looking into Latin America. And, I think it's an esoteric question to debate as to what is the middle class and whether it's emerging or not. I think when you mentioned that Latin America is going through an explosive growth, I think you took a little bit of poetic license, because it's not yet explosive growth. It has the potential to have explosive growth. And I think that if you look historically at development across the world, we invest in 31, 32 countries around the world. So I've had the privilege of actually seeing how middle classes pull countries out of poverty. And I've seen it across the world. So when we look at Latin America, I think if we stop and think, the middle class has always been the engine of growth across the world. If you have an empowered middle class, you have got economic development, you have prosperity. I think women, I agree with you, play a crucial and a key role. But if you go back to your original question, which is what is middle class? Middle class is anything, anybody who earns over $10 a day. And poverty is anybody who earns under $4 a day. And extreme poverty is anybody who earns under $2 a day. Now, these are World Bank definitions. Because $10 buys you a certain standard of living, $2 buys you a certain standard of living. I don't think that you can have all-encompassing statements saying that we've beaten the poverty trap and we've beaten the issue here. Yes, in Latin America, you have had a very resilient and a very strong progress towards reducing poverty. Brazil actually has led the path in doing that. But now you have a different issue. When you have more than $10 a day, you could have $1,000 a day, you could have $10 a day. The middle class itself is a very broad spectrum. And you have different classes within the middle class. You have different abilities to buy products. And therefore, your economy has got to be geared towards servicing the different elements of what constitutes the middle class. I think what you have in this region, although you are achieving success at reducing poverty, what you still have is enormous income inequality. And income inequality leads to social issues as well. Income inequality, if you look at the global landscape, 10 out of the 15 most unequal countries in the world still happen to be in Latin America. And that's just a fact, right? But that does not mean everything is doom and gloom. Actually, it's very positive. Because when you see the policies that are being followed in countries in this region, Brazil was the first to be recognized. And I feel it's important for all of us to say, what's our aspiration? The first thing that Latin America has to understand is when the world used to refer to us as emerging markets, I've always rejected the concept of calling us emerging markets. 2/3 of the world's growth is going to come from these markets that we populate, of which Latin America is a very important constituent. So the future prosperity of the OECD countries is a function of these markets. We call them global growth markets. And it's wrong and patronizing to call them emerging markets. If you have that mindset in government, you will flow that mindset down to people, which is that we are aspirational, we're growing, and we have a great future ahead of us. And within that context, if you look at what the middle classes can do, the best thing that governments can do is to empower the SME sector. The best thing the governments can do is to enable entrepreneurship to evolve and develop. Not everybody can be an entrepreneur. A lot of people have to go into the service sector. A lot of people have to provide jobs that are mechanical or industrial in nature. But if you can promote the environment and governments let people get on with the job of creating value through their own effort, which was the point I think you were making at the outset, then I think the middle classes in these Latin American countries actually do have a prosperous future ahead of them. And most important of all, I think what you have going for you in Latin America, which most other regions in the world don't have at present, is you've captured or are part of a trend that is actually leading the world today, which is urbanization. I don't know how many people here recognize and realize that today mankind is an urbanized race for the first time in its existence. More than 50% of us live in cities, and that number across the world is going up by 1 million people a week. That's 8 New York cities a year. Now, the good part about Latin America is you're already urbanized. You're leading the world in urbanization. There is more urbanization in Latin America than in Africa or in Southeast Asia. And because of that, cities are a hub of economic activity. And in cities, the demand for investment, especially new cities, especially tier two cities, is very strong. So what you land up creating, therefore, is jobs, business, big business and small business, SMEs, create the environment, the entrepreneurial environment for people to have jobs. And the baseline of middle class development is jobs, actually. Not government intervention, but jobs. And the better jobs you have, the better it is. I've heard government leaders in Latin America talk about and boast about, in fact, the fact that they have low unemployment. Well, low unemployment is not good enough. It's the quality of employment that you get, which is the flip side, that people should be focused on. So I think the fact that you're so urbanized is a great starting point for developing a middle class. The fact that you have jobs as a result that are going to be created and are already being created is crucially important. The most important element in conclusion that I'd like to say is that when you have an environment like that, the role of government becomes crucial. Typically, in the past, you've had a different form of governance. Now, increasingly, I'm seeing in Latin America a growing focus that to have development, you've got to have governance, not just government. And in the pursuit of governance, transparency, the rule of law, and so on, is becoming paramount. The Pacific Alliance is actually leading, in many ways, the world in its quality of governance and the way in which governments are reacting to developmental activity. And if that process continues, I think that the middle classes have a very strong future in this part of the world.
Rafael, would you like to add something? Yes, certainly. I would like to add a caution note of this optimism with respect to the middle class in Latin America. What has the World Bank said? It said that we've had an extraordinary decade in terms of economic growth, 4.2% in 10 years, a very good one. And Mexico has not done very well in terms of growth. I know I opened that parenthesis, but in general, it's been fantastic. That has allowed that between 70 and 90 million people to come out of poverty. Nonetheless, what I would like to highlight is that not because of that can we say that Latin America is not the region of the world with the worst distribution of wealth. That is the situation that is true and real in Panama. Colombia, Brazil, Mexico, Panama, other countries, you name it. That is a crucial truth, and it's amazing. I think that we need to have a higher sense of urgency, and we shouldn't be confused. There's an index that I like very much. It's the United Nations Human Development Index, which gives us interesting information. We are celebrating in Mexico the 20th anniversary of NAFTA. And if we ask ourselves, has Mexico converged with US and Canada? The answer is no. Barely this year, Mexico has recovered the level of income that it had in 1994. It was so brutal, that shock, that economic shock from 94 and 95, that we're barely just recovering to that same level of income that we had. Now, where there is a convergence, if we use the Human Development Index from the UN, in the fact that the index does not only use income, they also use other parameters like health and education indexes. And there we can see that countries like Mexico have progressed a lot in terms of health care coverage, and the life expectancy is practically the same as the people in the United States and the Canadian one. And also in education, there's much more coverage. So if we see the Human Development Index, we see that the gap is closing when compared to the United States and in Canada, but not in all indexes or all sectors. Now, I'd like to insist greatly on the fact that when we consider many of the issues of safety and security in Latin America, I'd have to agree with you that what Latin Americans steal the most are cell phones, gadgets. It's petty crime. This has a lot to do with that fact that wanting to aspire to be a middle class, Latin Americans that want to live as if they are middle class and they don't have enough money. Now, there's a very interesting topic. We carried out a study with the UNDP, and we carried out surveys in six different countries in prisons. Prisons of six different Latin American countries, and we realize that there's a paradox. Between 80 and 85% of the people in the prisons in those countries, which are Argentina, Peru, Chile, El Salvador, Mexico, and Brazil, the inmates, the people that are in jail, between 80 and 85% had a job before committing the crime. So it doesn't have to be to do with unemployment, but actually to supplement employment and the income. Now, I want to also say something optimistic. Where I do see a paramount change is in the values of the Mexican youth. I am a teacher in the Autonomous Superior Institute of Mexico, and I am always appalled by the fact that there are more entrepreneurs among the youngsters in Mexico. Yesterday, I was dedicated to speak with the different young people here, and it's fascinating to see how the Latin American youth wants a change and is seeking to do so through entrepreneurship and not through the government. And Luis, I agree with you on that. I think that there's a very important empowerment. We were educated in a certain way. They never told us or taught us the value of entrepreneurship. But now I don't think that we're teaching the young people, but they are taking it upon themselves. And I think that's fantastic in Latin America. With respect to gadgets and the theft of cell phones, I want to mention that we're doing a live transmission through internet. Please follow us through Twitter. We're using the hashtag LatamGrowth. So please follow us, and there's already a lot of activity. We currently have comments from Manuel Olano Luis to acknowledge that most of the people is middle class, is to remove excuses for development because we are poor. I think that Luis de la Calle began by saying something like that. It takes that black cloud that says that we're doomed and everything goes bad because we're poor. Now, in terms of aspiration also, the middle class, or that is to be middle class, is to aspire something. And to be part of a middle class is inspirational as well. Now, when the crisis of 2010 and 2009-2010 happened, the Coneval numbers showed how the middle class was the one that was affected the most. The urban middle class sector specifically, and many people went down to the level of poverty due to the loss not only of their ability for purchasing, but also the general income. Veracruz in Mexico, for example, is a good example. I think it was one of the most affected states. And also in the urban zones of Veracruz, the laying down of works or the firing of the people from their jobs led to this condition. So we were left in a very vulnerable position. Does this happen in other countries as well?
Yes, it does. And there is, like I was saying, there's almost a historical inevitability to some of these things happening. It comes back down, your question, actually, to the role of government. Okay, in Latin America, I feel, and a lot of analysts feel, that you also have a fragmented social contract. Okay. Governments are meant to govern for the benefit of the people, not to rule the people alone. And a fragmented social contract means that you already have a low tax base, and you have a very low expectation from people as to the delivery of services by government. The issue that a rising middle class will inevitably create is because they want more of everything, they're going to perhaps turn to self-provision of a lot of these services. And that's going to increase the income inequality all over again, because people that are in the middle classes will be able to cater to themselves for healthcare, for education, for logistics, and so on. And that's not necessarily a good thing. When I was talking earlier about jobs, I think you captured that point perfectly, which is people that are in prisons start off with having jobs as well. It's not the fact that they were employed. It's the fact that they were underemployed. It's the fact that their salary levels are not commensurate with what their social expectations are and what their aspirations are. So I feel that rather than constantly focusing on the doom and gloom and the negativity, we must look at the positive elements of what we have in front of us. We have markets that are growing at rates that are higher than elsewhere in the world. We have countries that have great potential. And because of a variety of factors, take, for example, the Pacific Alliance. Again, you all speak one language. You have customs union. You have free trade agreements with the United States. You have, you know, opportunities that are mind-boggling in terms of creativity and growth. Entrepreneurship is a very important element, but so is education, so is healthcare, so is so many other different things. The most important thing you need to focus on in this part of the world, and I want to say this in the most positive way, is the young people. I think you have a very high level of young people in your population. The interesting thing that you mentioned earlier about spending yesterday with the young people that are here, I spent day before yesterday with the same young people. Because Abraaj is one of the partners of the World Economic Forum in the Global Shapers Program. And I meet the same young people all over the world. Whatever I do, when I'm traveling, I make sure I meet the Global Shapers. There is a level of identical behavior amongst these shapers, whether I see them in Mexico and Brazil or here in Panama, or whether I see them in Nigeria or I see them in Istanbul or in Dubai. They're all the same. They're aspirational, and most important of all, they're empowered. They're empowered because they want more of everything and they have expectations which are high. And because a lot of them are entrepreneurs, I think your future is very bright because they want and are learning from opportunities and best practices all over the world.
Claro, estamos escuchando.
Yes, we're listening to the positive side, right? Once again, of an empowered middle class, a middle class that is also demanding, but we also have to turn on the alerts, the warnings. It's a middle class that can become a social pressure for governance. How can we solve aspects, Minister, on these demands? Brazil is a very young country also, but we have to open universities, we have to offer opportunities. Our youth in Latin America, I think, is one that doesn't have much hope when compared to other regions, at least that's my perspective.
It's true, in the case of Brazil, we have the highest youth we ever had and we will ever have. 51 million people between 15 and 29 years of age. This group is the group that I'm very concerned about this group. They are quite positive in a way. If you ask for young people in Latin America or in Brazil in particular, give a grade to your life in 5 years, life satisfaction from 0 to 10, in Brazil, they give a grade above 9 on average. And that's serious because they have very high expectations, so the probability they get frustrated is enormous. So I think it's, and so we have to devise, and this group is the door of change in our societies, where, yes, you know, we have a window to see how will be our countries in the future. And there has been a lot of change with this hyper-connectivity that affects mostly the youth. And sincerely, we don't know exactly what's going on. I think the youth themselves don't know what's going on. Their parents, even less. Business, even less so. And governments, even less so. You know, it's a big change happening. Like, for example, demonstrations in Brazil 1 year ago. I must admit, I didn't see it coming, and other, like in Middle East, etc. There is a change, a demand for an interaction. We are in a much more complex environment. We're going to have to be able to hear people, to interact, especially in terms of the youth. I think we have a great revolution. I agree completely with my friend there. For example, in the case of Brazil, in 1991, 85 of the municipalities had very low human development index. Today, less than 0.6. From 85 to less than 0.6, and mostly because of life expectancy and education. Not so much income as well, but not so much of income. And that's where the youth, we are losing a lot of lives in the youth. We can get even a bigger jump if we address the issues of violence and so on. And I agree completely, that's the difference between being non-poor and being middle class. Mm-hmm. I think middle class is something, it's not where you come from, it's where you want to get, it's a positive concept. That's why I like the idea. I just think that if you frame too much in the US standards, it's too far. You know, I mean, you're going to be rich. I mean, if you are middle class in the US, you are rich anywhere.
Yes.
You know, so, I mean, we're talking about wealth, not about, you know, people, what people can do. So I think we're in my minister, we are in charge of setting policies for the middle class, but it's not policies where the government's going to, you know, like in the case of Bolsa Família, is to allow creativity, is to allow education, the provision of public services, not by the state, by the public sector. It is a huge challenge we have ahead of us. And unfortunately, I think, I agree with you that entrepreneurship is key. Mm. But this new rise in middle class in Latin America, the main symbol, it's formal jobs, which is good news. But it's not yet opening a a business like in the U.S.
No, I think I completely agree with that. I think you're right. But, you know, formal jobs are important. Entrepreneurship is important. What I was trying to say, and I feel it's important, you've hit the nail on the head. All of this is to address the largest segment of our society, which is the youth, right? And you mentioned hyper-connectivity, you mentioned empowerment, and you mentioned the criticality of youth because they're tomorrow's voters. And what it was most accurate about what you said is government has no idea how to deal with these people, frankly, and neither do most of us. There aren't that many young people sitting in this audience either. But they are the future prosperity of all of our markets, but they're excited, and that's a good thing. And that excitement needs to be captured, and that excitement needs to be harnessed. And if we can focus that attention primarily around productive activity rather than crime, I think we have great societies in the making.
That's a whole issue. We could possibly dedicate one specific table to talk about the Latin American youth. I think it's one of the most important problems or issues to address. To see that they're studying, being productive, and being entrepreneurs, but we see that a lot of them are in the streets, and that's happening in our countries. Now, we have to be positive, right? I'm going to make a prediction. Latin America will be one of the main economies in the world in the next 20 years, mainly Brazil and Mexico. The rest as well, but due to the size and the scale, Brazil and Mexico are going to be one of the most important economies in the world. And I think that business people should think about, do I want to be in that economy? Do I want to step in today or when we're already big? We want to step in today. That's the simple answer. Obviously, for this poetic license, I think was the term that someone said, for this to be given, we need to build the conditions in order to be more productive. What Mexico has to do in the next 20 years is to increase our productivity 5 times more. That means Rafael, Mario, and my person, we have to produce 5 times more. But not working 5 times harder, but rather producing things that have 5 times more value. And the production of things that have more value depend on the entrepreneurship, which is mainly from the youth, and what they're going to see in terms of the decrease of inequality and opportunity for business. That is the most important thing, how the youth, the entrepreneurship, in the youth particularly speaking, they long to see and they want to work to see the balancing within the society, within our regions and countries. Their success is not going to be given if Mexico and Latin America, we don't have institutions that respect the rule of law. Ministro Juarez, who was a president in Mexico 150 years ago, said something, but we haven't understood this. The respect of others is competitiveness. Now, he didn't say it precisely in those words. Yes, that's a poetic license, I agree. He said the respect of others' rights is peace. That's what he said. When in Mexico, in Latin America, we respect the rights of others, people are going to invest in their own future. They're going to be able to use their home, for example, to leverage or to build a second story. They can sell, transfer, inherit, to have leverage over their asset. Now they can't do it because they're outside of the formal system of the economy. So we have to consider how we can integrate them. How can we make them part of the modern economy? I want to add 2 comments based on the previous interventions. If you consider the growth rate in Mexico in the past 20 years and you divide it per states, you're going to see that there are states in Mexico that have had Asian-style growth rates. For example, Querétaro, Aguascalientes, Baja California, South and North, Coahuila, Guanajuato. All of the states that are integrated to North America economically and their big success. The problem is that we have states in Mexico that have a negative contribution to the average growth rate. And these are the DF, the federal state, Oaxaca, Michoacán, Guerrero, Nayarit, and Campeche, specifically. Campeche has had in the past 20 years an average growth rate of -2%. And Campeche is just like Pemex. What has lowered the average in Mexico is the Mexican oil company, Pemex, that company. So the averages are deceiving. What you can observe is that the success of many regions and what needs to be done is to incorporate the rest of the country to that growth rate. Two final comments. The sales of cars in Mexico. In Brazil, the sales is close to 3 million, and in Mexico, we sell 2 million. And the car manufacturers would like to say 1 million because they ignore that we import 1 million used cars in Mexico, and the revenue from that is highly beneficial for the poor populations in the country. To close the border, which some want for the exportation of used cars, it's a high income, or high tax rather, to the low class. And I don't think they deserve that. You mean the public transportation is a problem? Yes. And public transportation is another issue where we have to emphasize that, for example, in Mexico, we're saying that line 12 didn't work right because we don't have enough resources. And it's precisely the opposite. It didn't turn out right because we didn't respect the right of other peoples. I wanted to return to the topic of middle class and simply just ask for us to be very aware to what is happening in the United States. President Obama has understood that there is an anger in the United States, specifically from the middle class, because they are the drivers in the United States, because people that work full time don't have enough time to meet their needs. And there's a terrible problem there. And we can learn from that. We have to pay attention to see how they work around this, because we are aspiring to that. But that model that we are aspiring to is not as functional as we thought it was. Well, we have to pay attention to that. Something else is I consider that what has happened in Chile has been fascinating with the demand that students have for there to be better universities and for them to be at prices that are available to them. And I think it's fascinating. And why Chile? Well, precisely because it's a Latin American country that in terms of this gap between poverty and richness has been closed more. And that's why it has happened in Chile. And I think that's sensational. I also want to insist on the topic of the need that there is in cities for being included or inclusive. In Latin America, for example, where we have big cities, I learned this yesterday in the lunch. Buenos Aires, Sao Paulo, the city of Mexico, have 25% of the Latin American population. And for example, in Mexico, I don't know if it's the case of Sao Paulo, but inclusion has been very important to have a city that is not violent. For example, the city has been popular for having less violence when compared to other regions. And to have access to public transportation, access to the general services, all of this renders in this result. I think that the Latin American mayors have to look at the examples of Barcelona, for instance, a city with a lot of connectivity, London also, how they have been transformed. I think it's fantastic to see what is happening in the world. And I am very optimistic with the youth, entrepreneurship, connectivity. There's a young Mexican lady here. I met her yesterday, and I saw her again today. She was taking a picture with President Peña Nieto, and I thought, that's going to be a good picture. She created a site. It's called something for internationalists, and there are already 12,000 young people from all of Latin America. And I think even the world, because through that site, they are finding jobs. And I think that's great. From these sites, we are getting jobs on a daily basis. And so I think that if we are able to have connectivity and inclusion in our cities, we can progress. I think that I hope that picture was a selfie because they're fashionable right now, right? Now, before going with the final thought from our guests, I want to open the microphone in case anyone has a question or a comment. We have someone in the back. Hello, Nicolas Shane from Chile. I'm an entrepreneur. Unfortunately, Mr. Fernandez is not as much as you say it, a problem in Chile is the concentration of wealth, and a lot of the studies actually show that the gap has been growing in the past years. What is surprising to me and what I miss from this discussion, I am the founder of the Entrepreneurship Foundation of Chile, and by far the problem, the main problem that we have in Chile and in Latin America is the cost of capital and access to capital. In Chile, the financial average cost of capital to open a small or medium enterprise is 43% of interest rates per year. The consumption credits are crazy. I don't even want to go into that. And the SMEs represent 9% of the GDP. 95% of the companies, of the SMEs, fail. I don't want to continue sharing all of this data, but it's truly alarming, and it's very severe, especially because of what I mentioned. Now, the problem is that there is obsolete regulation, and there's brutal concentration of wealth. And the government does not dare to do much, because all of the weight is done on put on the poor, the burden is done on the poor, and the bank superintendency doesn't say much. How can we identify this big elephant, this big burden, and take control of the situation and to really do something about it? Because we have been with this situation for 10 years, and technology is available for innovation. The cost of capital is just one example, but this is so important. And I would like to know your opinion and how this can be corrected. Is this an open question, or can we pass it to Mr. Naqvi? Because I think he might be able to provide interesting feedback.
That as well, because I think that the question is very, and the comments that you made are very accurate. There are facts that we can't get away from. And fact number one is 10 of the 15 most unequal, income unequal countries in the world happen to be in this part of the world. So you're right, the gap between rich and poor is absolutely there and growing. We can't get away from it. But when you talk about the issues surrounding SMEs, I think this is where you as populations need to focus, because this is where the hypocrisy of government comes in. Okay, the reality is every government leader talks about the importance of SMEs. Every government leader says, I really want to focus on developing SMEs and create an enabling environment, because that in turn will lead to inclusive growth, which was a very key point that you were saying. The point is, you can't have SME development unless you have access to finance. And access to finance at 43% rates is prohibitive, it's impossible. Why don't you have access to finance? It's because banking systems don't like lending to small and medium enterprises. And the reason they don't like lending to small and medium enterprises is because they prefer to lend to asset-backed lending opportunities. SMEs are not asset-backed lending opportunities. SMEs are much more entrepreneurial, arguably venture capital, much more around working capital. And banks don't like being in that segment. The only way banks are going to get into that segment is if the government allows credit availability into that segment at very cheap rates. Where's that going to come from? That's a partnership between entities and organizations like the World Bank and a local government. And without having the finance access sorted out, you'll actually never have the creative thrust towards employment and SME activity growing. It just won't happen.
Ministro, usted quería agregar algo también.
Yes. No, just to...
You would like to add something, Mr. Minister? And I...
But in Latin America, there is no continent in the world with higher inequality than Latin America.
But also fast social mobility at the same time.
Fast social mobility. But the trend of inequality in our continent, yes, in the last 10 years have been falling. Like in Brazil, the income of the 10% poorest grew 450% faster than 10% richest.
Agreed.
And this, in fact, is like you discover natural reserves, you know, oil, deep oil, something like that. You can, if you can explore that, you know, people coming from the bottom. So Latin America still has a long way to go in terms of fighting its inequality through the good way. Education, access to capital markets, access to assets, having good collateral, having markets. I think the perhaps the great revolution we have, I think in the last years, we gave the poor to the markets. During the crisis, this was good, but we have to give markets to the poor, well-regulated markets. But inequality is on the downward still phase, and this is a great opportunity. This is behind what the new middle class is all about. It's not only about growth. Growth is part of it. The other part is inequality reduction, and it's still a long way to go.
That's fair, but how do you address the access to finance? A cheaper ability to provide capital to now, enable small part, businesses to grow.
This is part of the inequality. You know, if capital, I mean, you know, we have lack of democracy, high inflation, high inequality, and very high interest rates because of uncertainty, because of lack of collateral, and also because sometimes experiences that do work, we don't pay attention at them. I had the opportunity to go to Nicaragua, Mexico, Peru, and it was in front of me the most interesting experience of microcredit in the northeast of Brazil. So there is asymmetry of information as well. There are maybe, you know, like $100 bills on the sidewalks, and we are not really looking at them in terms of microfinance. But we have to create better access to markets through collateral, as he said, through better education, through lower crime rates, etc.
Gran pregunta.
A very good question. You started debate here. Any other question for this panel? There, please.
Like they say, it's very expensive to be poor, right? So middle class, they have to pay twice for education. They pay to the government in taxes, and then they have to pay the private schools. They pay sometimes even three times for healthcare, to the doctor, to the government, and then to the private health, and then to insurance on the highest part of the economy. So my question is, what experiences have you seen in other parts of the world where you can convince governments that they should be, instead of service providers, there should be actually payers for the people that private sector that know how to operate more productively and better than them? And what examples have you seen that this has worked, and what recommendations would you give to people that are involved in these education and healthcare sectors to address government, to address official and regulators, so that we can work with them to reach this goal?
Somebody?
I just to make a small advertisement, the forum launched yesterday a report on public and private entrepreneurship exactly in Latin America on this topic of health, education. So it's a new report, fresh, coming out of the oven yesterday. So I think many of the, you have case studies in many different Latin American countries. It's a long answer. I think there you find, you know.
Yeah, but I want to say, sometimes in Latin America, and this might be a lot the case in Mexico, I mean, we have tended in the last 20 to 25 years to privatize a lot of things. And it seems to me that we have to have a strong state. What I'm saying is, for example, now the single most important problem we Latin Americans are facing is public security. Latin America has become, by all means, the most violent region in the world. We're losing every year more than 100,000 Latin Americans because of homicides. In the last 10 years, we lost more than 1 million Latin Americans because of the homicide crisis. And I'll tell you something. It is the state, the only provider of security. This is not for the private sector. This is not for society. This is security is a public good, and as such, it must be provided by the state. So we have to be smart in the ways we think about the state, because it seems to me that we have abused in privatizing some state affairs. And for example, now in prisons. The idea in Mexico, and that is the idea in a lot of places, that we should privatize the prison system. It will be a huge mistake. Let's look at it in California. In California now, those who own prisons in the private sector, they have become a huge lobby to continue to have very tough laws, to have a lot of people in prison in California. So, I mean, it's, I will say that, I mean, we shouldn't buy the recipe that less state is better.
Yes.
We need strong institutions in Latin America, and we have a deficit of institutions in Latin America, and we have to be very wise in how we use, I will say, public and private practices to strengthen, I will say, the democratic institutions in Latin America.
Bien.
Good. I would like to ask that now, just for reasons of time, the time is over. We have a few minutes to see if one of our guests could have sent some of the questions. It is very expensive to be poor. And to have a small, medium enterprise, it is difficult to have access to finance. And also, it's expensive to have healthcare, for example. And what we have to do is to transform a little bit the means that we see the problems. For example, in Mexico, an enterprise, a small enterprise and informal, when it does a cost-benefit analysis, what results is that it's not worth it to get into the informal business. So what we have to do is to increase the state force so to oblige them so it doesn't really work. What we have to do is to lower the cost of formality. That is the key. To make it attractive enough. So I'm not going to have access to the credit if there is no respect to ownership rights. It is incorrect, but that's the truth. We don't have in Latin America a regime to protect the rights of ownership, public and private, and of the community. We are not going to have finances. We're not going to have credit. What is more important is that the rate is the return that of the investment that is going to be done. If we can convince the participants in the informal markets that they are trapped and they cannot increase their productivity, that the return that they would have with that formalization is a lot higher than the rate of interest that is going to be charged in the credit. So, and when the credit is going to be formal, it's going to be a lot lower. In the health, from the health point of view, it's going to have to increase the scale that we have today. The state pays the cheap treatment. We have a cold, and then it's paid. But when we have cancer, then it doesn't really work in the opposite, that the citizen pays the cold, and the state subsidizes the bigger illnesses. Thank you very much, and thank you, to you. Thank you.
No, when you're having a discussion on a regional basis, it's always very difficult because everybody brings the example of a country as a good idea or a bad idea. And the problems in Chile may not be necessarily the problems in Brazil. Brazil's issues with a enhanced social mobility may not be being felt in Mexico, and so on and so forth. So it's one thing to look at a region and say that there is an answer. It's another thing to go country by country. I think there is a reality. It's called countries, right? I mean, we can't get away from them. And every one of them has different governments, different policies, some more enlightened than others, and some less. The thing, if you want to look at Latin America as a trading bloc, the first thing you have to do is to bring down the barriers in that trading bloc. If you bring down barriers within Latin America, easing mobility of people, easing mobility of capital, and easing mobility of product. Okay, that's one very important determinant towards enhancing and benefiting the middle classes. The second is you'll never get a uniform system of governance, but what you can have is pointers towards a uniform system of governance. We're living in a world which is incredibly globalized, and we're living in a world where countries get penalized often for the wrong reasons. Brazil is a classic example of being a part of something that our friend Jim O'Neill dreamed up, which was called BRICS. It was both a beneficiary of it and it got the curse of it. Brazil has little or nothing in common with China or India, but it is classified together, and so it gets the benefit and the curse. I think if every country looks at its issues individually, the one thing every country in this region needs is more capital. Capital will flow to those countries that are transparent, and capital will flow to those countries that are welcoming and have a governance structure that can enable free flow back and forth. There's no two ways around it, because capital has no loyalty. This is another very important fact, okay? Capital has the ability to be deployed in country X or country Y. I'm deliberately not taking names, because that then is a function of the returns that it generates. Latin America needs an enormous amount of investment, ladies and gentlemen, in infrastructure, in soft infrastructure and hard infrastructure. Governments don't have the money for that infrastructure. And arguably, the wealthy are not going to invest in it overnight. It needs an enabling environment. For foreign capital to come in, especially in infrastructure, you need long-term thinking, long-term development, and most important of all, governments that are capable of accommodating that capital coming in. And that's the best thing that can happen for the middle classes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Naqvi, for your participation. And finally, Minister.
Okay. I think Latin America is following what you may call a middle path. No growth with inequality reduction. There is much to come from that. We need, you know, productivity boost. That's a key agenda. Savings, a very low savings country. Immigration to be open to attract talent. But I think that's what population wants, a middle path. Don't want all, you know, growth, but not all social. We need big states and a big private sector, and good, I mean, to explore the qualities of both. That's what people want, and we are in a democracy, so there is like a constraint in that. So I think it's the middle path. Brazil is in the BRICS. BRICS, I agree, is a different concept because it's a concept of differences, not of similarities. It's not like the usual regional bloc that fight for its interests. The interests are diffused that. But I think it's very interesting to be with China and India. I mean, you have 40% of the world population talking to you. I don't think this is a curse. But in my opinion, you know, we are in the year of the World Cup. I think the most important group Brazil is in are the bigs. What are the bigs? Brazil, Italy, and Germany. Those who won most World Cups, in that order, please. Okay, so I think there is this symbolic part, you know, that's what this middle class is about. It's about dreaming, you know, the Latin American dream, and this, I think, is in the Latin, the middle class incorporates this idea.
And Brazil will be the next champion?
Hopefully.
I hope that. Thank you very much. Gracias a todos ustedes por estar aquí con nosotros.
Thank you very much, and thank you to you too. It's a topic like a middle class took us to talk about very important topics such as the youth, the financial problems, the differences that there are in definitions and the reality of each country. We thank you for to follow us in internet and TV. Thank you, and to the next one.